I'll start by sharing a story of a church that I heard of down in the United States. And there was a minister there who was feeling some of the financial pressures, you know, trying to meet the bills. And there was church repairs that needed on the roof and that were vastly under budgeted for. And so he was quite stressed about this on this particular Sunday and trying to figure out how he would address this issue to the people. And so he was a little annoyed when he found out when he arrived at church that the regular organist was sick and that a substitute organist had been brought in at the last minute. He thought, oh great, one more stress. And the substitute was after him to know what she was to play. Well, here's a copy of the service, the pastor said impatiently, but you'll have to think of something to play after I make the announcement about the finances. So during the service, the minister came to that place in the service and he paused and he said, brothers and sisters, we are in great difficulty. The roof repairs cost twice as much as we expected and we need $4,000 more. Any of you who can pledge $100 or more, please stand up. At that exact moment, the substitute organist played the Star Spangled Banner. And that is how the substitute organist became the regular organist. Well, the story I thought was rather pertinent for us as Remembrance Day is just around the corner. We always sing O Canada, so I'm sort of thinking maybe I should talk to the wardens and see if maybe this is a strategy we could employ here. Well, as I mentioned at the outset of the service, this is the Feast of the Dedication. And it's an occasion where we celebrate the life of the church, we reflect on ourselves here at St. Matthew's and our parish, and we think about what the church is, and perhaps even what the church is not. Now, if you were to speak to folks in our society about what they thought the church was all about, you probably get some different responses. You might get people thinking, like folks maybe in that first story who think the church is always after our money, or are looking to raise money for different issues. But you know, for as long as the church has been in existence, it's been met with intense criticism. It's often been blamed, sometimes rightly, and other times wrongly, for many things and many problems in our world. And this has been true since the earliest days of the church. In the ancient days, when the church was oppressed by the Roman Empire, authorities deemed Christians enemies of the state for their refusal to worship Caesar as their Lord and their allegiance to Jesus Christ. They were also accused of being incestuous because they referred to each other as brother and sister. Some even called them cannibals for their practice of eating the flesh and drinking the blood of Christ. And then over the centuries, critics continued to step up and criticize and say negative things about the church. You may have heard the common well-known criticism that the church is simply the opiate of the masses, right? That Marxist claim. A crutch to lean on or an intoxicant to mask one's problems. Others have held the church to blame for the oppression of women and minorities and held accountable for a myriad of other social problems. Comedian George Carlin once quipped, I'm completely in favor of the separation of church and state. My idea is that these two institutions screw us up enough on their own, so both of them together is certain death. Another critic, Emile Zola, a 19th century French writer, wrote, civilization will not attain to its perfection until the last stone from the last church falls on the last priest. As a priest, I'm really hoping that Zola is wrong on that one. Now, it's true that the church has often failed morally and spiritually. At times, the church has stood as an impediment to social progress rather than an instigator. But we also know that the church has done and continues to do wonderful works in the world. From the development of universities and hospitals to being a forerunner in civil rights movements and worldwide peace and relief initiatives, we know that the church is also capable of great good. So why the dichotomy? Why it seems that we're capable of both good and ill? Well, the simple answer is that the church is made up of people, and we people are not perfect. Charles Spurgeon once said that the day we find the perfect church, it becomes imperfect the moment we join it. I think that's true. On the Feast of the Dedication, we celebrate our parish here at St. Matthew's for all of our strengths, and in spite and perhaps even because of all of our weaknesses. We are invited to reflect on our self-understandings of what it means to be church. And today's readings can assist us greatly in this, as they reveal insights into who we are and what we are not. Let's take a quick look at the psalm, for example. The psalm opens by extolling the beauty and wonder of the temple of the Lord. "How lovely are your courts," the psalmist exclaims. "Happy are those who live in your house. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere." And the psalmist goes on and on about how especially he loves being at the temple, or we might think of it in today's terms, in the church. But if we were to explore this psalm a little more, we find another truth. We find that the psalmist shifts, and we see that this poem that appears to be about a place is actually more a doxology or an expression of praise about a person. The poem is saturated with names for God: Lord of hosts, living God, my King and my God, God of gods, God of Jacob, who is sun, shield, water, nest, all in all. The temple, then, can be seen as an access point to the reality of God. And we might think of the church in a similar fashion, that the church can be an access point to the reality of God. See, the church seeks to point beyond itself, beyond what these structures and symbols and stained glass and all the decor that we have are meant to point beyond themselves to the living God. We are not the end, but rather a means to the God who is the beginning and end of our lives. A second thought we might ponder from the readings today is that we, the church, are not to be a self-enclosed retreat center. I once heard a parishioner say, "Well, I go to church because it's the one thing in the world that never changes." That didn't quite sit well with me, to be honest. To this person, he found that the world was this tempestuous place, a frightening place to live in. And he felt he ought to be able to find refuge in church. We might recall the psalmist talking about the birds that build a nest in the church, that even the birds find a home, a rest, a sanctuary, a peaceful place in church. And there's some truth to this. But the church is not to be a place that shuts the doors to the outside world and locks in the fearful in order to try to avoid the change and challenges that are out in the world. In our gospel today, we find such a gathering. The disciples, having witnessed the torture and death of their Lord, have locked themselves in a room for fear of what will happen to them. And the resurrected Christ has already appeared to some, but that news has not yet healed the fear in their hearts. And into this house of fear, Christ appears. And that encounter fills the disciples with peace. "Peace be with you." Jesus says these words as he shows them his death scars. And then he sends them out. He says, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." You see, the revelation of the risen Christ carries with it a commission. The one who is himself the agent of God deputizes the disciples to also become agents of God. His mission from the Father becomes the paradigm for their mission in the world. The words of peace, Jesus' peculiar gift to the disciples, which was different from the world's gift, are not for them alone, but are meant to be spoken through them to other groups that are crouched behind bolted doors, dismayed and upset, who have not yet heard or find it hard to believe that death is not the end. And this commission that Christ gives them also comes with the gift of empowerment. And we hear that rather strange expression that Christ breathed on them. And this expression echoes Genesis 2:7 in the creation account, when God breathes on humanity to bring it life. The giving of the Spirit signifies a new creation, a new community that declares a gospel of forgiveness. And this new community could also be called a spiritual house made up of living stones that St. Peter speaks of in our epistle today. Scholarship around the time of this epistle believes that this was a book written to a group of people who were socially displaced and dispossessed, not only spiritually and religiously, but socially, economically, and politically. They didn't really fit in their culture. Their home was somewhere else. They were a disparate group. But together in Christ, they formed a new community. They've become a spiritual house. A spiritual house, a spiritual community linked and intricately tied to Jesus Christ, who is the author and creator of this community. And this spiritual house is not to be simply another social club that exists solely for its own members, but rather it is to be a household of which God is the head and the cornerstone is Jesus Christ. It is to be a house of peace made up of living stones. My friends, today we ought to reflect on these images and themes about what it means to be the church, to be a spiritual house made up of living stones. Do we exist for the benefit of one another? But also, are we truly, as it was once said, the one organization in the world that truly exists for the benefit of others? When we gather in this place, what are we trying to point to? The people who come into this place see us as a potential point of contact between the material and the immaterial, between the secular and the sacred, between the human and the divine. Is our worship engaging? Is our spirituality inspiring? Are we a place that people can encounter the risen Christ and have their fear turned into peace? Are we a place where Christ meets with us, empowers us to share that peace with one another and out to the world? There is a custom in our churches, one that I found very peculiar when I first came into the Anglican Church, and that is the exchange of peace. Now, here at St. Matthew's, our custom is at the outset of the service to greet one another, and that's become a bit of a substitute for later in the service when the priest echoes the words of Christ and says, "The peace of the Lord be always with you." Now, in a lot of Anglican churches and Catholic churches and other liturgical churches, that moment of the exchange of peace is actually quite different from, say, what we do at the outset of our service. Because the exchange of peace isn't really about a meet and greet and a saying of a good morning. That's, like I said, we do that at the beginning. The exchange of peace comes on the heels of the confession and absolution, where we receive God's mercy, forgiveness, healing, and peace. And as the forgiven and as the healed, we are commissioned to share that peace with one another. And so today in the service, we're actually going to exchange the peace when we come to it in the service. But I would invite you, as that we, when we do this, we say the words, "The peace of Christ," or "The peace of Christ be with you." That when we say those words, we would really mean them. And that it wouldn't be necessarily a "Hi, good morning, how are you today" kind of encounter. It would be an encounter with God's peace. It would be a spiritual practice as part of our spiritual house, this community here at St. Matthew's. And when we do this, may we experience even just a token of that peace that God would use to mend our broken hearts and to point to the God who is our peace. And may it be shared not only in this place, but out to the world, casting out fear in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our risen Lord. Amen.